you're walking along the street, or you're at a party, or else you're alone, and then you suddenly dig. You're looking in someone's eyes, you suddenly realize that this could be the start of something big.
Over the years, the subject of feminism in Hollywood cinema developed into a complicated and tricky topic, asking questions which it's sometimes easier just to shove aside. These movies were made in the past. They're painfully dated. They're crazily problematic. The concept of femme fatales, damsels in distress, and flat love interests all spring to mind. They set feminism in our culture back decades, right? Well, Are You a Bad Girl sets to explore this very question. How do we see feminism perceived throughout the classic Hollywood studio system? Could some of these films even hold up when viewed through a contemporary lens? Throughout this series, my goal is to look at the films and figures from the popular culture of the middle of the 20th century in an examination of the evolution of feminism, the positives, the negatives, and ultimately how our society evolved to the place we are right now. In our first episode, we're going to spotlight one of the most iconic femme fatales to come out of the film noir movement in the episode Gilda, Glenn Ford, and the End of World War II. Film noir is an iconic cinematic movement which gained traction during World War II, with the recognized beginning often cited as the 1941 John Huston classic, The Maltese Falcon. Hovering somewhere between a movement and a genre, film noir ran throughout the 1940s and deep into the 1950s before its ending with 1958's A Touch of Evil. Some well-remembered classics like Out of the Past, The Postman Always Rings Twice, Double Indemnity, and today's film of discussion, Gilda, make up some of film noir's greatest hits. You don't have to be a film historian to know at least a little something about the film noir movement. Everyone has flipped past one or two during a late PBS or Turner Classic Movies airing. Visually iconic, the images of private detectives, sultry femme fatales, and rain-soaked city streets are easily discernible. Scholarly analysis has broken the movement down to include a number of common stylistic contextual traits, ranging from cinematography emphasizing darkness and shadow to melancholy narrative structure hitting at the feudal nature of post-war life. Life kicks you hard, and then you die. It's just that simple. No one in film noir is entirely good or evil. Nothing is black and white. There's just a whole lot of gray. I grew up a fan of film noir, getting my official entree thanks to watching the 1947 film Kiss of Death in the midst of a lengthy Richard Widmark phase in middle school. Yes, you did hear that right.
Mr. and Mrs. North and South American, all the ships at sea, let's go to press. This is Walter Winchell broadcasting from Hollywood. I just came from a projection room at 20th Century Fox Studios where I saw a picture of my town, New York, and my time now. Ladies and gentlemen, the title of this moving picture is Kiss of Death. In underworld lingo, kiss of death can be many things, none of them good. A pat on the shoulder from a pal that turns into a bullet in the back, or a kiss from a woman's warm lips that sends the victim to the morgue. Like Boomerang and the house on 92nd Street, this one has authenticity stamped all over it. It is red meat. It is factual. It's a close-up of the tenderloin in action. Its tempo is terrific. And its story is that of a squealer. In underworld code, a squealer is marked for death. One man sneered at the code, squealed, and didn't die. That's what makes Kiss of Death such a gripping and exciting moving picture.
Kids like to hit. We'll all have some fun together. You and me and your wife and your kids. Touch my family and you'll hear singing like you never heard before. Go on, beat it.
Nick, he's a three-time loser now. All we've got to do is catch him with a gun on him and we can send him up for life.
And suppose he don't make a mistake. He didn't the last time. You made the mistake.
Sooner or later, he'll trip himself up. They all do. You've got to trust me.
I'm through trusting you, the police, or anybody but me. There's only one way to get you, though. And that's my way.
If you like action as I do with entertainment, you'll find it here. This one was written with a machine gun.
Thank you. While I fell head over heels into the movement's most popular films, I managed to miss Gilda for an embarrassingly long time. While I eventually heard about Rita Hayworth's role, which would make her famous, I never caught the movie until my film school days. Gilda was one of the first movies we watched during a women in film class, for obvious reasons. I fell in love with the movie and film noir all over again, and this in turn propelled me into questions of gender and sexuality in cinema, which remain one of my biggest research interests to this day. In fact, it is my work with Gilda which served as the inspiration for starting this series. Beware, there will be spoilers abound, so you have been warned. I will be spoiling the heck out of this 73-year-old movie. Gilda follows the story of Johnny Farrell, played by Glenn Ford, a drifter and American expat in Argentina. He finds himself embroiled in action and intrigue when he finds himself falling for the wife of his business partner, Gilda, played by Rita Hayworth, in the role which would follow her for the rest of her life. Actors George McCready and Stephen Geray co-star in the film, which was written by Marion Parsonnet and directed by Charles Vidor.
To him.
I just told him if a man answers, hang up. Didn't you hear about me, Gabe? If I'd been a ranch, they would have named me the Bar Nothing.
There never was a woman like Gilda, or a picture like Gilda. Columbia's outstanding screen triumph, starring Rita Hayworth with Glenn Ford.
That's what I told Val, and that's what you're going to tell him.
Making me deceive my husband.
I got some news for you, Gilda. He didn't just buy something. He's in love with you.
One man bought Gilda. Another hated her and hungered for her.
I hate you too, Johnny. I hate you so much that I think I'm going to die from it. Darling.
Gilda, inflaming men's hearts with a kiss or a song.
Amado mio, love me forever. And let forever begin tonight. Put the blame on me, boy. Put the blame on me. One night she started to shim and shake. That brought on the Frisco quake.
Make her stop. What do you mean by it?
Now they all know what I am. And that should make you happy, Johnny. It's no use just you knowing it, Johnny. Now they all know that the mighty Johnny Farrell got taken. And that he married a...
Most are familiar with Gilda thanks to Rita Hayworth's iconic take on the titular character. While the actress had been around Hollywood for much of the 1930s, her career only truly took off at the beginning of the 1940s thanks to her roles in films like Blood and Sand and You'll Never Get Rich. She initially made a name for herself under the name Rita Cancino with an uncredited role in the 1934 film Cruz Diablo. While much knowledge of the film is lost to time, the Mexican feature is described as a take on the iconic story of Robin Hood. The next year, Hayworth translated the debut to a busy year with credited roles in movies like Charlie Chan in Egypt.
Can't you help me find him, Mr. Chan? You must. You've got to.
If possible, we'll be most happy.
There. Let Nida take you to your room, my dear.
Sorry. Good night. And thank you, Chan.
It took 10 years of hard work, but by 1944, she found herself constantly top-lining films through much of the rest of her career. Born Margarita Carmen Cancino in 1918, a look into the actress's past shows a particularly powerful example of studio-enforced whitewashing. Her early roles saw the actress typecast due to her appearance. Publicity photographs would show what studio bosses of the period would describe exotic beauty, which matches the role she was landing during the period, which always cast her as Egyptian, Gypsy, and Spanish. The descriptions of the then barely 20-year-old Hayworth's plastic surgery have remained fairly consistent with the passage of time, with most sources agreeing the young actress underwent an intensive electrolysis to adjust her hairline, among other painful procedures. A simple examination shows the immense changes she underwent during the tail end of the 1930s, which seemed particularly noticeable in 1937. Over the span of just a year, she moves from a role in a film called Old Louisiana as a character named Angela Gonzalez, where she's still billed as Rita Cancino, to playing characters with names like Betty Morgan and Mary Gillespie in small pictures like The Shadow and Paid to Dance. While her hair is still dark, the woman on screen feels a lot more like the iconic redhead audiences would grow to love over the next decade. Gilda hit theaters in April of 1946 and starred Hayworth opposite actor Glenn Ford, who's probably best known to contemporary audiences for playing Pa Kent in the now classic version of Superman. Ford made his initial screen debut in 1939's Heaven with a Barbed Wire Fence.
Why should I?
That's a nice town.
It's okay if you're a big shot. But working in a department store basement ain't my idea of living. I'm kissing it all goodbye tonight.
Don't try jumping off. It's against the law.
Don't worry. I ain't jumping. I just come up here to take one last good look at this burg and do this.
Well, I suppose everybody's got a right to his own opinion.
You said it. I'm pulling out tonight.
How far are you going?
3,000 miles.
California?
No, Arizona.
Ain't much work out there.
Now, there's plenty of work for me. I'm a property owner. I got a ranch out there. I'm going out there and I'm going to work my ranch and I'm not going to take orders from nobody. Not ever again.
Yeah?
Yeah.
How big a ranch?
20 acres.
20 acres?
That's right.
Boy, that must have cost you some dough.
Yeah, it cost plenty. Say, I did without most everything for 6 years saving up. Lunches, shows, Coney Island. But the minute I got that deed, I quit my job. Now I'm on my way, and I'm never going to see another basement again.
You don't tell me.
Yeah, sure. I'm headed for Shady Acres. Shady Acres, Arizona, my bet.
Shady Acres. Boy, what a ranch.
Yeah, ain't it a beauty?
However, like Hayworth's, his climb to stardom was a lengthy one. He established himself as a genre go-to throughout the early 1940s, but most of those titles have largely faded into the haze of history. As such, Gilda is most certainly his first major role in a career which would span more than 50 years. Interestingly, the movie also represents a flip in Ford's career from the star persona he established in the years before the war. His early years were spent in westerns, often the low-budget variety. But Gilda presents an entirely new Glenn Ford to audiences. While he routinely paired himself with strong leading ladies like Barbara Stanwyck, Ida Lupino, and Gloria Graham, it is only Rita Hayworth who truly seems to challenge his mid-20th century masculinity. In his other films of the era, usually it only takes a good hard kiss or a solid slap to bring a wayward leading lady under control. Rather, Gilda is solidly in control in this film. In a 1953 interview quoted by scholar Stephen Cohen, it seems Ford consciously tried to avoid future roles that resemble Johnny. He's quoted as saying, "One of the things I found out in making pictures outside of Hollywood is that my fans don't want to see me dominated by women. They might take it from other men, but they resent it when it happens to me. Thank you, Glenn." This cringeworthy quote speaks a lot to the roles Ford played, particularly into the 1950s in movies like The Big Heat.
To my home about a murder?
Get rid of him. Let's go, mister.
What's your pitch, Lucy?
What is this information you have?
Stop the cross-examination. I didn't come up here to talk out of school.
Why did you come up?
Why don't we call it research or something?
Come on. Better check with Lagana first. He might not approve.
I'll have your badge and gun, now.
It's yours. Permanently.
I asked for your gun, too.
It doesn't belong to the department, it's mine.
I'm warning you officially. Don't try to use it.
However, in Gilda, the usually tough as nails Ford is pitted against an equally tough leading lady who is not afraid to challenge his traditionally masculine authority. And it drives him absolutely nuts. A hallmark of the film noir movement, the concept of the femme fatale is an idea as old as literature itself. As film developed into a medium of its own, archetypes like the vamp and the spider woman partially assumed the characteristics of the fatal woman. However, the concept developed an interesting life of its own with the explosion of film noir during the 1940s. Scholars Raymond Bord and Etienne Chameton described the femme fatale as a new woman, manipulative and evasive, as hard-bitten as her environment, a long way from the chaste heroines of the traditional Western or historical dramas. In fact, it is the femme fatales of film noir who captivate and fascinate audiences today, and it is these women who are perhaps best remembered from this era of cinema. Most are familiar with Rosie the Riveter. With the outbreak of World War II, men were suddenly being drafted and enlisting to fight the fascist threat overseas. According to the National World War II Museum, the various branches of the military touted the strength of over 10 million individuals in 1944. However, with that mass exodus, there became jobs on the home front which suddenly needed filling. Aided by well-constructed government propaganda like Rosie the Riveter, women flocked to the workplace in droves, many for the first time as factory and defense workers, cab drivers, and really any other job which needed filled. Ad campaigns proclaimed it was their job as an American. Someone needed to keep the home front running. In Rosie the Riveter Revisited, Schoenberger Gluck examines the female workforce in the period directly surrounding the war. In 1940, a fourth of all white women and nearly 38% of black women were wage earners. It even became acceptable from others, normally restricted just to homemaking, to work outside the home. Gluck continues, in 1944, at the height of war production, almost one in three defense workers was a full-time homemaker. Their addition to the workforce meant that married women outnumbered single women workers. This was how they could make the boys proud. This was how they could support their husbands, their brothers, and their sons. However, in 1945, the war came to an end. While there was undoubted elation, the drastic return to normalcy brought with it inherent complications to the United States home front. The sudden influx of servicemen from the battlefront would be needing jobs, and the only problem is that the women filling these jobs weren't always ready to return to the kitchens from whence they came. It is this sociological setting out of which film noirs like Gilda crafts their narratives, particularly in relation to the subjects of gender and sexuality. This is particularly relevant when examining the femme fatale as a character archetype. Almost without exception, these women are known for their independence as well as their dynamic and unapologetic natures. They're delightfully fun characters to play, and this is perhaps why so many are so well remembered. From her first scene in this movie, the strength is completely noticeable within Gilda as a character. Prior to her entrance, the movie is far from Hayworth's. Rather, Glenforge's Johnny is actually built up as the figure for an audience identification. It is Johnny who we follow, and it is his narration shaping the story. We first see Gilda as Johnny and Balin enter her bedroom. She flips her hair as she comes into view with a sultry glance. The male gaze is a possessive and owning act, and this is clear from Johnny's eyes as he looks over Gilda.
Gilda. Are you decent?
Me? Sure, I'm decent.
However, Gilda's return of his gaze as Johnny looks over her shows that she's not so willing to be dominated. In her character's now iconic introduction, Gilda takes control of the gaze, returning it in Johnny's direction almost frankly. In fact, the camera returns to Johnny. He's showing he's just as fetishized and as pretty as she is. Scholar Richard Dyer describes this. He is softly lit, with his weakly sensual mouth in particular highlighted. His hair brilliantined, this rendered an interesting visual surface, and he is fastidiously dressed. All at once, the gaze is flipped back on Johnny just as quickly. The movie pulls no punches in showing that not only is Johnny attracted to Gilda, but she is seeing him in return. In the almost loaded pauses between the dialogue, she pulls the strap of her dress higher on her shoulder, a subtle reaction to the frank nature of the gaze. And it is this mutual gaze between these characters and the potentially destructive attraction between them fueling the narrative. While this independence is a commonality among femme fatales, Gilda's treatment within the narrative is not. She takes a very dominant role with Johnny throughout the film, the bluntest instance occurring early when she meets Johnny for the second time.
I found him, Gilda. Very elusive chap, huh, Johnny?
Sit down, Johnny.
Good evening, Mr. Farrell. You're looking very beautiful.
Good evening, Mrs. Munson.
Can't you return the compliment, Johnny?
You're looking very beautiful.
Why, thank you. If there's anything I love, it's a spontaneous, impulsive compliment like that.
The phrase, you look beautiful, has been used throughout history, both in fiction and reality. However, it is almost always directed towards women. The mere fact that Gilda tells Johnny he looks beautiful overtly feminizes and demeans him in the narrative, placing him squarely in the feminine role. Only a few minutes later, Johnny and Gilda butt heads over her dancing with a man who is not her husband. When the other man notices Johnny's disdain for Gilda's behavior, her response is telling.
Hello.
Good evening, senorita. Senor, I am Capitan Delgado. I would like to ask permission to dance with your lady.
The answer is no.
The answer is yes. I'd love it.
But the young man.
The young man would love it too, but he can't afford it.
Women can be extremely annoying.
These attacks on Johnny's masculinity are more specifically an attack on his lack of financial stability. In the post-war climate, with women gaining an increasing foothold in the workforce, the ability of a man to provide for his family was a tender subject in the changing country. This becomes increasingly visible into the 1950s with the idea of the vulnerable and struggling man in the gray flannel suit. Throughout the scene on the dance floor, the equality in the gaze is staggering. While the male gaze is represented, a number of shots look at Gilda matching Johnny's eyeline almost perfectly. Not only does the camera observe Gilda looking back at Johnny, but it also matches her eyeline at points. In a film where so many long-standing gender roles are undergoing such drastic transformation, the story actually seems open to the changes. The clearest evidence of this is in the final fade of the titular character. I don't mean to give spoilers, but it is rare to see a femme fatale and a noir survive the film. Even if they do, a happy ending is rare. Thus, it is significant that not only does Gilda remain largely unpunished, but her character does receive a happy ending. Gilda's sexuality is openly displayed, and the second half musical number put the blame on Mame, otherwise known as the striptease.
They once had a shooting up in the Klondike when they got Dan McGrew. Folks were putting the blame on the lady known as Lou. That's the story that went around. But here's the real lowdown. Put the blame on me, boy. Put the blame on me.
The provocative dance is Gilda's revenge on Johnny. Over the course of the scene, she removes only a single glove, much to the delight of the male-dominated audience. She's at the height of her powers and very much in control of the gaze during this sequence. She pounces on their enjoyment.
I'm not very good at zippers. But maybe if I had some help.
I'll help you.
I am an expert.
Watching the scene play out, it becomes immediately clear how comfortable Gilda is with her own body and in turn her own sexuality. The number also demonstrates her ability to use her sexuality to her advantage, and ultimately this is her strongest revenge on Johnny.
What do you mean by it?
Now they all know what I am. And that should make you happy, Johnny. It's no use just you knowing it, Johnny. Now they all know that the mighty Johnny Farrell got taken, and that he married a...
She wants to humiliate him, and ultimately she is successful. She's sexual, she's free, and she is a bad girl. And she's not supposed to come out on top. It is this version of the song which draws the greatest physical response from Johnny. This is the only way Johnny can dominate her, through physical force. Put the Blame on Mame is showcased a number of times throughout the film. The lyrics are a pointed reference to how women are blamed for all of society's ills. The Chicago fire, the San Francisco earthquake, everything is caused by this Mame, drawing a larger comparison to the role of the femme fatale in the film noir movement. How much of their fatal nature is real, and how much of this is really the fault of society? Gilda is indicative of the sudden power women developed in society in the absence of servicemen. Gilda's a drifter. She's made her own way in the world. We know very little about her past, with only a vague hint that she and Johnny may have had a past together at some point. On one level, the film develops Gilda as a gold digger when Balin says,
"I bought her, Johnny. Just as I bought you."
However, moments later, the man retracts this statement.
Money doesn't mean very much to Gilda. If she should become restless... I'm mad about her, Johnny.
Rather, Gilda is flippant about money and the lavish gift showered on her by her husband.
And because you're so nice, I'm going to show you something. My husband gave it to me for a coming home present. Is it cute?
50,000 pesos and it's cute. Isn't she fabulous, Johnny?
Fabulous.
Her primary enjoyment comes not from Balin's money, but from the tremendous social life she leads when she's with him. Johnny keeps the social and extroverted Gilda isolated in their house and away from the active lifestyle to which she is accustomed. However, she's never reliant on Johnny. Angry at him, she flees Argentina in an attempt to get an annulment. She's an independent woman with no strings to tie her down. She's fully able to sustain herself without the support of her rich husband.
It finally got to her that Buenos Aires was her own private prison. That's when she decided to run away.
She went to Montevideo, got a job singing in a nightclub, started divorce proceedings, and met a man.
On a superficial level, the film makes her seem like a gold digger, just out for the money and the support of her rich husband. However, after a closer examination of the dialogue and the film's action, it is clear that Gilda drifts as she needs to. She's able to get a job and support herself through her nightclub singing. As a movement, film noir also evolves into a fascinating breakdown of post-World War II masculinity in a number of ways, many of which stretch deep into the 1950s, as mentioned earlier. The noir hero drifted away from the hyper-masculine leading men of the war years. We know the type. Cary Grant, Errol Flynn, John Wayne. All these guys had no trouble killing a man while winning over the leading lady, sometimes even at the same time. They didn't have to work that hard at it either. Just a few years later, nothing came easy for the noir leads like Glenn Ford, Dana Andrews, and Humphrey Bogart. Bourde and Chameton write in their essay Towards a Definition of Film Noir, an ambiguous protagonist, he is often enough masochistic, even self-immolating. One who makes his own trouble, who may throw himself into peril, neither for the sake of justice nor from avarice, but from simply out of morbid curiosity. At times, he is a passive hero who allows himself to be dragged across the line into the gray area between legal and criminal behavior. Johnny Farrell is a unique hero in the context of film noir. His polished appearance and character development distances himself from the typical lone wolf hero of the movement. These men were often world-weary, hard-drinking, and rough around the edges. One of the most often analyzed elements of Gilda involves the time and care spent developing the relationship between Balin and Johnny. Some would call it homosocial or even blatantly homoerotic. Regardless, the relationship between the two leads goes through more development and crafting than the one either man has with Gilda. The relationship between Balin and Johnny is documented from their first meeting, while it is only stated that Johnny and Gilda were once an item. At the same time, nothing is really shown about Balin and Gilda's relationship, only that they are in fact married. However, Balin and Johnny's relationship begins with an almost sultry pickup line. Ow.
Get going. Cane like that can come in handy. It is a most faithful and obedient friend. It is silent when I wish it to be silent. It talks when I wish it to talk.
That's your idea of a friend?
That is my idea of a friend.
You must lead a gay life.
I lead the life I like to lead.
You're a lucky man.
I make my own luck.
What are you doing in a neighborhood like this?
I came down to save your life.
Don't overdo it. He wouldn't have killed me if I'd given him the money.
But you wouldn't have given him the money.
The foundation of their relationship is set with the equivalent of a no girls allowed sign placed on the casino door. Even Balin at one point says,
"This I must be sure of, that there is no woman anywhere."
"There's no woman anywhere.
Gambling and women do not mix.
Those are the very words I use myself."
In her essay, Film Noir, Voiceover in the Femme Fatale, Karen Hollinger discusses the overt attraction between Johnny and Balin. She writes, "The narrative presentation of the strong attachment between the two men hints at a homosexual involvement between them that Ford later indicated was obvious to the two actors as they fashioned their roles. Thus, Johnny is suddenly reduced to an angry and betrayed lover when a new figure is introduced."
"When did you get married?"
"The day after that."
"Quick. You should know, Johnny, that when I want something, I..."
"You buy it quick. Do you know anything about her at all?"
"It's an odd coincidence, Johnny. Listen to this. She told me she was born the night she met me. All three of us with no pasts, just futures. Isn't that interesting?"
"I think it's fascinating."
"What's the matter with you?"
"I thought we agreed that women and gambling didn't mix."
"My wife does not come under the category of women, Johnny."
"I could have made a mistake."
"You did. Don't make it again."
The Balin and Johnny relationship is an interesting one. Is it one of homoerotic tension? Or should it be interpreted as something like a reverse Oedipal thing where the son, Johnny, is trying to kill the maternal figure, Gilda, to get closer to Balin's paternal figure? It's complicated. Despite all of this development, the relationship between the two men really shows the film can't seem to decide an answer, leaving the pairing interesting but decidedly ambiguous. Even film theorists today can't seem to agree. Ultimately, it is a convention in classic Hollywood that the protagonist defeats the villain and successfully wins the heroine, the happy Hollywood ending. Interestingly, the conclusion of Gilda goes against both these traits, rendering Johnny ineffective in the traditional role of the male protagonist. The only way he can win Gilda back reduces him to begging. He must beg for her to take him back to America with her.
"Going home. I came to say goodbye. I want to go with you, Gilda. Please take me. I know I did everything wrong."
Suddenly, Gilda finds herself with all of the power. She doesn't have to take Johnny back. In fact, it is telling that she is given the narrative high road in the moment.
"Isn't it wonderful? Nobody has to apologize. Because we were both such stinkers, weren't we? Isn't it wonderful?
Wonderful."
In this admission, the film is excusing not only Johnny, but most importantly, Gilda. They both have been bad. Then adding potential injury to insult, Balin resurfaces from the grave with the intention of killing both Johnny and Gilda. Johnny is trapped with no weapons. Officially helpless and with Gilda watching, all he can do is back away from the rapidly approaching Balin. He's emasculated. And then Johnny and Gilda are saved by Uncle Pio, who is the only one able to kill Balin. Thus, the narrative is not ended by the hero, but the comedic relief coming in the form of the club's washroom attendant. The conclusion of the film is unique and defies so many long-standing Hollywood norms. The hero is rendered completely ineffective against both the heroine and the villain as the closing credits roll. Gilda comes from producer Virginia Van Upp. While her name has faded a bit with the passage of time, Van Upp holds the distinction as one of the few women working in the higher echelons of the movie industry during the classic Hollywood era. She pulled herself up, earning her first screen credit in 1934 as a screenwriter on The Pursuit of Happiness. Van Upp is one of two writers credited, sharing billing with J.P. McAvoy on the Joan Bennett period piece. Over the next few years, she ranked in a number of impressive credits, writing for everyone from Jimmy Stewart to W.C. Fields. By 1944, Van Upp took another gigantic step forward in her career. That year, she received associate producer billing on the Jean Arthur vehicle, The Impatient Years. The same year, she's billed as producer on the Irene Dunne and Charles Boyer feature Together Again. Van Upp is also credited as a screenwriter on both films. In April of that year, Van Upp secured the film which would change the course for the rest of her career. After having spent most of her time at Paramount, she joined the creative team over at Columbia to work on the musical Cover Girl. The now classic feature stars Rita Hayworth, Gene Kelly, and soon television legend Phil Silvers. It also partnered her for the first time with Charles Vidor and screenwriter Marion Parsonet, both of whom she worked with 2 years later on Gilda.
Here we go again.
Let's keep on singing, make way for tomorrow. The sun is bringing a new day tomorrow. Don't let the clouds get you down. Show me a smile, not a frown. Stand up and win, turn about. Don't give in, let's give out to the blues. Just refuse to surrender. One smile and you are a true Charlottesender. What if it rains and it pours? It only rains out of doors. Let every frown disappear and you'll find that tomorrow's here.
Listen all, this is genius calling. Hear ye!
Hear ye!
Why not gather rainbows while ye may?
While ye may.
You can lose the gremlins, the goblins, the glooms. Laugh, ha ha, they're back in their tombs.
Let's keep on singing, make way for tomorrow. The sun is bringing a new day tomorrow. Don't let the clouds get you down. Show me a smile, not a frown. Stand up and win, turn about. Don't give in, let's give out to the blues. Just refuse to surrender. One smile and you are a true Charlottesender. What if it rains and it pours? It only rains out of doors. Then all the clouds disappear and you'll find that tomorrow.
After Van Upp's success on Cover Girl, studio boss Harry Cohn brought her to the studio as an executive producer. The unprecedented move put Van Upp in charge of some of the studio's top pictures. A woman in charge during this era is exceptionally rare, with select few being granted the freedom. The number of prominent female directors could be counted on one hand, let alone women in power at the executive level. The January 7th, 1945 issue of the New York Times describes Van Upp's position as the most important executive position yet for a woman at a major studio. She will have the overall supervision of the preparation and filming of 12 to 14 top budget pictures to be made by Columbia. The article, entitled Hollywood Bows to the Ladies, was penned by Fred Stanley and goes on to detail that several associate producers working under Van Upp were all men. Much of Van Upp's work during the period is listed as uncredited, with Gilda being the film probably best remembered by contemporary audiences. The movie is one of a number of times she worked with Ford, with An Affair in Trinidad and The Loves of Carmen being the other two. Hayworth's career seems almost intrinsically linked with Van Upp's, and the two were described as fast friends. Van Upp's career can be traced in the 1950s, as she still indulged her passion as a writer. She passed away in 1970 at the age of 68. Hopefully we'll look more into the life and work of this talented lady as the weeks go on. So much has been written about the lack of women working in the higher echelons of Hollywood during this era, that the works of those who were working during this period seem to fade into the metaphorical sands of time. Ultimately, the narrative treatment of Gilda and her relationship with Johnny Farrell demonstrates a surprisingly progressive attitude on the part of the filmmakers towards the changing gender roles evolving during the Second World War and the immediate post-war period. While Gilda commits all the violations which would usually condemn a femme fatale to death in other works of film noir, she's openly sexual while still being independent and strong. These traits could earn a slow and painful death scene, but Gilda not only gets the boy, she gets the happy Hollywood ending. As a film, Gilda is light years ahead in anticipating the changes in gender roles that began during the Second War, but ultimately weren't firmly set in place until the onset of second wave feminism almost 20 years later. Stay tuned for more from me. My name is Kim. Find me on Twitter and Instagram on kpierce624. I'm on Facebook as well if you drift over that. Stay tuned, and if you like this, definitely rate, review, and subscribe.